seller is no longer under the sign of the sinister projects of diabolical men. But it's perfectly natural, inherent to the nature of an underground world. By following Henri Bosco, we shall experience a house with cosmic roots. This house with cosmic roots will appear to us as a stone plant growing up of the rock. Out of the blue sky of a tower. The hero of L'Antiquaire, having been caught on a compromising visit, has been obliged to take the cellar, Right away, however, interest in the actual story is transferred to the cosmic story. Realities serve here to reveal dreams. At first, we are in the labyrinth of corridors carved in the rock. Then, suddenly, we come upon a body of murky water. At this point, description of events in the novel is left in abeyance. And we only find compensation for our perseverance if we participate by means of our own night dreams. Indeed, a long dream that has an elemental sincerity is inserted in the story. Here is this poem of the cosmic cellar. Just in front of me, water appeared from out of the darkness. Water. An immense body of water. And what water? Black. Stagnant. So perfectly smooth that not a ripple, not a bubble marred its surface. No spring and no source. It had been there for thousands of years. Remained there, caught unawares by the rock, spread out in a single impassive sheet. In its stone matrix, it had itself become this black, still rock, a captive of the mineral world. It had been subjected to the crushings of mass, the enormous upheavals of this oppressive world. Under this heavy weight, its very nature appeared to have been changed as it seeped through the thickness of the lime slabs that held its secret fast. Thus it had become the densest fluid element of the underground mountain. Its opacity and unwanted consistency made an unknown substance of it. A substance charged with phosphorescences that only appeared on the surface in occasional flashes. These electric tints, which were signs of the dark powers lying on the bottom, manifested the latent life and formidable power of this still dormant element. They made me shiver. But this shiver we sense is no longer human fear. This is cosmic fear, an anthropocosmic fear that echoes the great legend of man cast into primitive situations. From the cavern carved in the rock to the underground, from the underground to stagnant water, we have moved from a constructed to a dreamed world. We have left fiction for poetry. But reality and dream now form a whole. The house, the cellar, the deep earth achieve totality through depth. The house has become a natural being whose fate is bound to that of mountains and of the waters that plow the land. The enormous stone plant it has become would not flourish if it did not have subterranean water at its base. And so our dreams attain boundless proportions. The cosmic daydream in this passage of Bosco's book gives the reader a sense of restfulness, and that it invites him to participate in the repose to be derived from all deep oneric experience. Here the story remains in a suspended time that is favorable to more profound psychological treatment. Now the account of real events may be resumed. It has received its provision of cosmicity and daydream. And so, beyond the underground water, Bosco's cellar recovers its stairways. A after this poetic pause, description can begin again to unreal its itinerary. Quote, a very narrow, steep stairway, which spiraled as it went higher, had been carved in the rock. I started up it. By means of this gimlet, the dreamer succeeds in getting out of the depths of the earth and begins his adventures in the heights. In fact, at the very end of countless torturous, narrow passages, the reader emerges into a tower. This is the ideal tower that haunts all dreamers of old houses. It is perfectly round, and there is brief light from a narrow window. It has a vaulted ceiling, which is a great principle of the dream of intimacy. Like those old bed frames that go like this, right around the bed. Whoa, a bit much. For it constantly reflects intimacy at its center. No one will be surprised to learn that the tower room is the abode of a gentle young girl. And she is haunted by memories of an ardent ancestress. Cliches. The round vaulted room stands high and alone, keeping watch over the past in the same way that it dominates space. Vertical space. On this young girl's missal, handed down from her distant ancestress, may be read the following motto. The flower is always in the almond. Flower like F-L-O-W-E-R. I'm gonna circle it. What does that mean? I don't know. With this excellent motto, both the house and the bedchamber bear the mark of an unforgettable intimacy. For there exists no more compact image of intimacy, none that is more sure of its center, than a flower's dream of the future, while it is still enclosed, tightly folded, inside its seed. Okay, the flower is always in the almond seed. I get it now. I like that. How we should love to see not happiness, but pre-happiness remain enclosed in the round chamber. Finally, the house Bosco describes stretches from earth to sky. It possesses the verticality of the tower rising from the most earthly, watery depths to the abode of a soul that believes in heaven. Such a house, constructed by a writer, illustrates the verticality of the human being. Walk upright, we see that makes us cool. It is also onirically complete in that it dramatizes the two poles of house dreams. It makes a gift of a tower to those who have perhaps never even seen a dovecot. A tower is a creation of another century. Without a past, it is nothing. Indeed, a new tower would be ridiculous, but we still have books. And they give our daydreams countless dwelling places. Is there one among us who has not spent romantic moments in the tower of a book he has read? These moments come back to us. Daydreaming needs them. For on the keyboard of the vast literature devoted to the function of inhabiting, the tower sounds a note of immense dreams. How many times since reading L'Antiquaire have I gone to live in Henri Bosco's tower? This tower and its underground cellars extend the house we have just been studying in both directions. For us, this house represents an increase in the verticality of the more modest houses that, in order to satisfy our daydreams, have to be differentiated in height. If I were the architect of an onirical house, I should hesitate between a three-story house and one with four. three-story house, which is the simplest as regards essential height, has a cellar, a ground floor, and an attic, while a four-story house puts a floor between the ground floor and the attic. One more floor, and our dreams become blurred. In the Oneric house, double analysis only knows how to count to three or four. What's up with that? Okay. Then there are the stairways. One to three or four of them are all different. We always go down the one that leads to the cellar. It is this going down that we remember that characterizes its onerism, wonerism. But we go both up. But we go both up and down the stairway that leads to the bedchamber. It is more commonly used. We are familiar with it. 12-year-olds even go up it in ascending scales, in thirds and fourths, trying to do fifths, and liking, above all, to take it in strides, four steps at a time. What joy for the legs to go up four steps at a time. Lastly, we always go up the attic stairs, which are steeper and more primitive, for they bear the mark of ascension to a more tranquil solitude. When I return to dream in the attics of yesteryear, I never go down again. Dreams of stairs have often been encountered in psychoanalysis, but since it requires an all-inclusive symbolism to determine its interpretations, psychoanalysis has paid little attention to the complexity of mixed reverie and memory. That is why, on this point, as well as on others, psychoanalysis is better suited to the study of dreams than of daydreams. The phenomenology of the daydream can untangle the complex of memory and imagination. It becomes necessarily sensitive to the differentiations of the symbol. And the poetic daydream, which creates symbols, confers upon our intimate moments an activity that is polysymbolic. Our recollections grow sharper. The Oneric house becomes highly sensitized. At times, a few steps have engraved in our memories a slight difference of level that existed in our childhood home. A certain room was not only a door, but a door plus three steps. When we recall the old house and its longitudinal detail, everything that ascends and descends comes to life again dynamically. We can no longer remain, to quote Joe Pisquet, men with only one story. He was a man with only one story. He had his cellar and his